Good morning, church, both in person and online. Today, I will be reading Psalms 32. Blessed is he whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. Blessed is the man to whom the Lord does not impute iniquity, and in whose spirit there is no deceit. When I kept silent, my bones grew old through my groaning all the day long. For day and night your hand was heavy upon me. My vitality was turned into the drought of summer. I acknowledged my sin to you, and my iniquity I have not hidden. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord, and you forgave the iniquity of my sin. For this cause, everyone who is godly shall pray to you in a time when you may be found. Surely in a flood of great waters, they shall not come near him. You are my hiding place. You shall preserve me from trouble. You shall surround me with the songs of deliverance. I will instruct you and teach you in the way you should go. I will guide you with my eye. Do not be like the horse or like the mule, which have no understanding, which must be harnessed with bit and bridle, else they will not come near you. Many sorrows shall be to the wicked, but he who trusts in the Lord, mercy shall surround him. Be glad in the Lord and rejoice, you righteous, and shout for joy, all you upright in heart. May the Lord bless the reading of this word. Thank you.
Good morning and welcome to our Sunday service this morning. To everyone that is in person here as well as joining us online. Come, let's just open with a word of prayer, even as we come and worship the Lord together. Lord, even as we have just heard the reading from Psalms 32, about what it means to be blessed and to receive your forgiveness, even as we bring our iniquities before you. We want to pray that this morning as we come into your presence, let there be found no deceit in each of our hearts. And that deceitfulness is basically means us trying to cover up our iniquity. And we come before you this morning acknowledging that you are holy, that you, O Lord, is also a merciful and gracious God who will forgive us even as we come in humility and in sincerity. Therefore, we want to just pray that as we worship you, accept, Lord, this our worship, not just with words, but also from our hearts. And we just ask for your presence to just be with us this morning. Come, Holy Spirit, lead us and also help us to worship in liberty, in spirit, and in truth. We want to just give thanks to you in Jesus' name. Amen. Over to you, Siew Cheng.
You know, this morning, even as Pastor has said about making ourselves aright, and as we quieten our hearts, let us be assured that the Lord will strengthen we who are weary, and he will give rest to us who are heavy laden. And we ask of the Lord to pour forth their Holy Spirit, his Holy Spirit, to be in this sanctuary and cleanse us of all sin and put our heart aright as he refreshes our hearts. Because it's written in Jeremiah chapter 31, verse 25, it says, the Lord says, I will refresh the weary and satisfy the faint. Refresh our heart, Lord. Come and refresh our heart, O Jesus. Shall we all rise?
Refresh my heart, Lord. Renew my love. Pour your spirit into my soul. Refresh my heart.
You know, in Isaiah 61, verse 1 and 2, it says, "The Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is on me because the Lord has anointed me to preach good news to the poor. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim freedom for the captives and release from darkness the prisoners, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." You know, it's still January and I can still wish you a blessed new year. And well, this verse was prophetically written on what our Lord has come to fulfill. And even as we love God, we love people, and even as we are to make disciples, we just ask the Lord to help us. What is it that you want us to do this year, Lord? But whatever it is, Lord, let this year be the year of the favor of the Lord. Thank you, Father. That's just one name that's above all things and above everything, and it is Jesus. He came from glory, took on flesh to save the lost. Thank you, Jesus.
Amen. Indeed, Jesus Christ is Lord, and He is everything. He is above everything. Please be seated. When I returned from the cross-cultural mission field, some people asked me this question. So, are you still a missionary? Good question. Mission is not a role or a position. Mission is a lifetime calling for me. Mission is a lifetime calling for every one of us. Mission is a lifestyle that God given us different gifting to point people to Jesus. Simple as enough, like this. There are numbers of missionaries who are worshipped in our SSMC. Because of time constraint, today I only highlight a few of what they are doing. But if you have any questions or anything you want to ask more, please welcome to contact me, because I will not name them. Neither their picture will be here. As a sending church, that we want to acknowledge them. We want to affirm their gifting and to pray for them. During these 2 years of pandemics in Malaysia, many are affected. That including the migrants and the refugees in Malaysia. So these missionaries are named Jay, and some of the volunteers, they take this opportunity to reach out to the Pakistani community by distributing the food to Kajang, Sento, Kepong, and Stapa areas. Suicide cases has been increased even to the migrants community. With the first response, the team, they started this online training to train the community leaders so that they are able to support various community, which begin with the Nepali and the Pakistani community here in Malaysia. Missionary X, I name, has been serving with the drugs, prison and HIV ministry for many, many years. Even during this pandemic, food and cash distribution to HIV-infected community is still ongoing even today. And I find very cool is, wow, this missionary able to conduct Christian classes in prison, in Kajang prison and Sungai Buloh prison. Isn't it amazing? Matthew 25 says, "For I was hungry, and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty, you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you invited me. I needed clothes, and you clothed me. I was sick, you looked after me. I was in prison, and you came to visit me. I tell you the truth, whatever you did for one of the least of this brother of mine, you did it for Jesus." These missionaries, P and S, heavily involved in training over the past many years. Due to the pandemic, actually online training has opened up a greater opportunity to equip, to mentor, and to coach not only the local leaders, but also the international leaders. One of the joyful testimony that shared by them is to see God multiply the impact of this online workshop beyond location, beyond East Asia, and also beyond their organization, as well as into other many different languages. And many churches planted in least rich area. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. All glory to God. Come SSMC family, come join with me to pray for our missionaries, whether they are named or they are not named here. But you know who are they. Come, let's pray for daily walk with Jesus, that I'm the vine and you are the branches. This kind of close relationship become the top priority, not only for the missionary, but every one of us here. Let's pray for the anointing and the empowerment of the Holy Spirit to walk with them. and make disciples. Thirdly, let's pray for protection over them and their family in physical, emotional, and in spiritual. Lastly, not only pray for missionaries, but also pray for us as well, that we will continue to fan into flame the gift of God that God has given to us. Come, church, let us pray together. Let us rise and pray together. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Lord Jesus, we want to give thanks to you. Thank you for all these missionaries. You call them my name. You know them. You know each and every one of them. We thank you for their life. We thank you for their response to your calling. We thank you that they faithfully serve you all these years and many years to come. Father, we pray that you renew their love and to walk with you closely every day as they have experienced the heart, the Father love of God, and the heartbeat in mission field. Lord, we pray. You protect them and their family as well, Lord Jesus, that no weapon formed against them shall prosper, including the viruses, Lord. Oh Lord, we stand before you in person and in online. That Paul reminded Timothy, in 2 Timothy 1:6 says, to fan into flame the gift of God, that we may not forget or neglect that the gift of God given to us, already given to us, but we wanted to continue to fan into flame, fire in us. Lord, you us, here we are, send us to the field you have called us to, Lord, for your glory and your kingdom. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen.
Won't you, Lord, take a look at our hands? Everything we have, use it for your plan.
Won't you, take a look at our heart, molding, refining as you set us apart.
Won't you, Lord, take a look at our hands? Everything we have, use it for your.
take a look at our hearts. Molded, refined, as you set us apart. We want to run to the altar and catch the fire to stand in the gap between the living and the dead. Give us a heart of compassion for a world without vision. We will make a difference, bringing hope to our land. Won't you, Lord, take a look?
Difference, and whether it is corporately or individually, Lord, it begins with each one of us. Thank you in Jesus' name. You may be seated. Very good morning to everyone, whether you are on site here in this sanctuary or you are online. There's a gentle reminder to our children, get your worksheets ready and do what you can, all right? And talking about the children, and just now we have been singing about altars and fire. I must share this story with you to start off the sharing. You know, the children in our church, they have what is called the Children's Prayer Altar, CPA. And they do this twice a week, on Thursdays in BM, and on Sundays in English, 8:15 to 8:45, only 30 minutes, half an hour. And what a wonderful half an hour they have each time. Last Sunday, we were privileged to attend the prayer altar with the kids, and they were on their systematic routine to pray for each couple of the leadership team, the LT, each week. And last Sunday was our turn. So Evelyn and I, we joined, and I was warned ahead, get ready, they will ask you, what is it you want to be prayed for? So I was a bit ready. So when they said, yes, Uncle Henry, what would you like? So I told them with fear and trembling, I'm going to be sharing the sermon in a week's time. So pray for me, number one, that I won't be nervous. Number two, I won't be chonghei, long-winded. And number three, that I will say only what God wants me to say. Sounds like a mouthful, and a lot for little children. But before you know it, a little girl, 6 or 7 years old, said, yes, I will pray. And she prayed almost word for word, exactly the 3 points that I requested. And she was paying attention. And more important, I sense in my heart, she was praying with conviction. She believed what she prayed. And I want to say thank you, Anyi, and all those who attended the children's prayer altar. By the way, even if you don't have children who are of that age, you can come to the children's prayer altar, either in BM on Thursdays or on Sunday. Only half an hour, you will be blessed. All right? Let's pray that the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable to you, our Lord, our Rock, our Redeemer. Pastor started the year with a call to remember the past. You will remember, we started that, and I think how aptly and how timely it was to start with that reminder that the past is not to be swept away and, okay, let's reinvent the wheel and start something new. And there's this danger each time when a new leadership takes over, in their enthusiasm, in their excitement, in their passion, they tend to forget the good works, the faithfulness of the past leaders, the founding fathers. And Pastor Robin was very right in saying we need to remember the past, to recognize the past, so that we can together build on the past. It is something that we do, we fall away and forget about it, but remember the best practices, not forgetting challenges too, but together look to Jesus our God, and we build on and move on to greater things that He has for us. And of course, we are told and reminded again of this catchphrase, slogan, mantra, whatever you call it. I just want to remind you, friends, you are not going to get away from it. Week after week, DG after DG, prayer meetings after prayer meetings, we are going to remind you to love God, love people, and don't forget to make disciples. And this is essentially not something Robin had one night and slept and think about it and the Lord showed him. This is from the scriptures. And so, listen, people, the Lord does not ask very much from us. Only this, the great commandment, Matthew 22, if you are familiar, verse 36. Jesus was asked, teacher, which commandment is the law is greatest? And Jesus said to them, what? You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the greatest and first commandment. And the second is like this. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. So we have the great commandment. And of course, we all know we have to put action to what we believe, what we understand, the great commission. The last verses of Matthew 28. Therefore, go make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. Listen, to obey everything. We'll come back to obey. So here we see that this love God, love people, make disciples call, just a reminder that it is not linear, meaning one thing has to happen, finish, then the second thing, finish, and then make disciples, you're all ready, can go to heaven. No, this is cyclical, repetitive, and overlapping, of course. And something else that Pastor reminded us, the centrality of all this is the Jesus template. We will talk a little bit, what does template really involve and what does it mean? But first, some of you in leadership have read this book or would have been reading. This is Hwayung's latest book, and his favorite topic, of course, leadership or servanthood. And I want you to look at his secondary title of the book, Walking in the Steps of Jesus. And in page 80, if you are reading, go back to it. Bishop Emeritus Hwayung says this: if we are to live in the security of God's love as Jesus did, love God, you remember the diagram and the Jesus template, as Jesus did, then the first thing we have to do is to face the truth about ourselves. A time of self-examination, then we can go on to enjoy the security of God's love, and all the while following the Jesus template, walking in the steps of Jesus. That's the Jesus template. So to explain what is template, in the old-fashioned explanation and definition, old-fashioned means people in my age group, a template is something that you use to cut, say, a piece of leather or textile or cloth, whereby the end result will always be the same, but when the finished product is seen, you will have stitching or it may be a different color. You will end up looking slightly different, but because it was cut from the template, which never changes, it will always be the same. The original intention is not lost because of that pattern, because of that model. But because that pattern is used, the purpose, the use, the intended service is not lost. Just like in production. But today, in the IT world, when we say template, many of us younger people will be thinking about your PowerPoint template, your Excel template, a sample document, already basic details in place. And according to your needs, you fill it in, but still, the template is there, all right? So this is what we mean by the Jesus template. Always back to the model, the pattern that never changes, Jesus. Remember many years ago, we had this popular catchphrase, what would Jesus do? Really falls back to the Jesus template. So just very quickly, this, as we said, is a repetitive cycle. It goes on, they overlap, and you, as you love God more, you will find that it's increasingly easy to love people. And then it will spur you on to put legs to what you believe, and you want to make disciples, even as the Great Commission asks, of all people, of all nations. And you would remember in Pastor's trilogy of sermons, the last one he mentioned, how do we love God? That would be the $64 million question. And you recall, he asked, write down, what action verbs come to your mind? It's not enough just that in our minds, you remember, it has to go down to your heart and then to your hands and feet. And I looked through my notes, and there were two words that I wrote during Pastor's sharing. One is, I can love God by serving. But when I serve, there could be a degree of sacrifice. Serving Him sacrificially is one way we can demonstrate our love to God. And sacrifice, we know, is synonymous with altars. And today we want to spend a little bit of time on this issue of altars. What you see here is a 17th century Rembrandt painting. You can't see it very clearly, but it is Abraham and young Isaac, who was bound and being prepared to be sacrificed, and then the angel in the top left stopping Abraham. Very vividly captured by Rembrandt, you can see the knife falling to the floor. And this was on a place called Mount Moriah. Remember the name? Mount Moriah, 4,000 years ago. We read in Genesis 22, first 18 verses. Abraham bound his son at the altar on Mount Moriah. And I'm sure there were a lot of questions running through his mind. And through his tears as he held the hand on both the bound Isaac, how could it be, Lord? This is the son you promised me. But yet, in obedience, as he prepared to bring the knife down on his beloved Isaac, God stopped him and acknowledged his abiding faith and obedience in him. We read in verse 18, and through your offspring, the blessings came, you know, the covenant. Through your offspring, all nations will be blessed. Why? Because you have obeyed me. Circumstances Abraham then did not fully understand, but his faith brought him to trust God, and that trust converted into obedience. And we see another Renaissance painting, painter unknown. Those of you who have read the story of David and the threshing floor will recognize this event. You can see David on the far right with the altar he was building, and around her, the owner of the threshing floor. And then here we see the angel of death stopping what he was supposed to do to bring the plague on to more people. That's a parallel narration in 1 Chronicles 21. But today I will very quickly, I think it's important for us to know the background of this threshing floor. The titular, that means the title, concept of what we are talking about. And again, this was on Mount Moriah, 1,000 years later. That means 3,000 years ago, David built an altar to the Lord on this threshing floor of Arauna, the Jebusite. What was the background to it? So if you have your Bibles, please refer to your Bibles. 2 Samuel 24, starting verse 1. Again, the anger of the Lord burned against Israel, and he incited David against them, saying, go and take a census of Israel and Judah. Already united kingdom. So the king said to Joab, the commander, and the other army commanders with him, saying, go throughout the tribes of Israel from Dan to Beersheba and enroll the fighting men so that I may know how many there are. Go and take a census, in other words, of the fighting men. But Joab, the commander, said to the king, may the Lord your God multiply the troops 100 times over, and may the eyes of my Lord the king see it. Why does my Lord the king want to do such a thing? The king's word, however, overruled Joab and the army commanders. So they left the presence of the king to enroll the fighting men of Israel. Then the details of where they went, we jump to verse 8. And after they had gone through the entire land, they came back to Jerusalem, capital city, at the end of 9 months and 20 days. See how accurate and detailed the narration is. Joab reported the number of the fighting men to the king. Israel, northern kingdom, there were 800,000 able-bodied men who could handle a sword. And in Judah, 500,000. 1.3 million, you know. And verse 10, we read, suddenly a change of heart. David was conscience-stricken after he had counted the fighting men. And he said to the Lord, I have sinned greatly in what I've done. Now, Lord, I beg you, take away the guilt of your servant. I have done a very foolish thing. In the past week and the week before, we have been reading the Psalms, mainly of David, and we see that virtue in David now, the broken and contrite heart each time he speaks of. So, verse 11, we read, before David got up the next morning, the word of the Lord came to Gad, the prophet, David's seer, his spiritual advisor. God told Gad, go and tell David, this is what the Lord says. I'm giving you three options. The punishment for disobedience. Choose one of them for me to carry out against you. So Gad went to David and told him, choose one of these three. 3 years of famine in your land, 3 months of fleeing from your enemies while they pursue you, or 3 days of plague in your land. Now then, think it over and decide how I should answer the one who sent me, meaning God. David said to God, I am in deep distress. Let us fall into the hands of the Lord, for his mercy is great, but do not let me fall into human hands. Here I think David recognized, no matter what, mati-mati, he wants to surrender himself to God and see and surrender it to the Lord. And not because it was human logic to choose 3 months, 3 years, and then finally to fall into 3 days of plague. No, it wasn't that. But because he knew the importance of surrendering to the Lord. So the Lord sent a plague on Israel that morning until the time designated, and 70,000 people from Dan to Beersheba died. And when the angel stretched out his hand, see the picture, to destroy Jerusalem, the Lord relented concerning the disaster and said to the angel who was afflicting the people, enough, withdraw your hand. The angel of the Lord was then, where? At the threshing floor of Arauna the Jebusite. And when David saw the angel who was striking down the people, he said to the Lord, I have sinned. I, the shepherd, have done wrong. These are but my sheep. What have they done? Let your hand fall on me and my family. On that day, Gad, the prophet, the spiritual advisor, went to David and said to him, go up and build an altar. Go up and build an altar to the Lord on the threshing floor around the Jebusite. So David went up, and as the Lord had commanded through Gad, so when Arauna looked and saw the king and the officials coming, he went out and bowed before the king with his face to the ground. Remember, David is king over all, and that is just a section where Arauna was king with the Jebusites. And Arauna said, wanting to carry favor, of course, why has the Lord my God, my Lord the king, come to this servant? David said very simply, to buy your threshing floor. Why? So I can build an altar to the Lord. Why? That the plague on the people may be stopped. And of course, Arauna said, no, let my Lord the king take whatever he wishes and offer it up. Take the oxen, threshing, sledges, ox yoken for the wood. Your majesty gives all this to the king. Arauna said, may the Lord your God accept you. But the king replied to Arauna, David, the king, replied to Arauna, "Listen, no, I insist on paying you for it. I will not sacrifice to the Lord my God burnt offerings that cost me nothing." So David bought the threshing floor and the oxen and paid 50 shekels of silver. And he built an altar to the Lord there and sacrificed burnt offerings and fellowship offerings. Then the Lord answered his prayer on behalf of the land, and the plague was stopped. So we see here the famous assuring words that David declared, "I will not sacrifice to the Lord my God burnt offerings that cost me nothing." And on that same spot, Mount Moriah, we are still on your time traveling, huh? 5 years later, David's son, Solomon, was asked to build that temple. And the threshing floor now became an altar in the great Solomon's temple. And this was in accordance to scriptures. However, 500 years later, this temple, historians call it the first temple, was destroyed by the Babylonians, led by Nebuchadnezzar. 500 years later, this magnificent building was destroyed. And later, much later, during Jesus' time, the second temple was built by Herod. But this too was destroyed in AD 70. Still on Mount Moriah and altars and temples. So what you see here is a picture of Mount Moriah. It's actually a ridge of mountains. And today, the actual spot of where the threshing floor was, Solomon's temple, Herod's temple, Abraham's encounter, is what we call today the Dome of the Rock or the temple. This is not a mosque, contrary to popular belief, but a Muslim shrine on that exact spot. But less than 2 kilometers away, just outside the city walls, we see what is all of us know as Golgotha, the place of the skull where Jesus hung on the cross and died for us. So we see here, on this same range, not the exact spot, 2,000 years ago, this supreme sacrifice took place. The final sacrifice, the perfect sacrifice, the all-sufficient sacrifice. That sacrifice when Jesus, the Son of God, died for us. And indeed, that range of Mount Moriah. And so, if you go today, you will actually see the Dome of the Rock and Golgotha. But let's very quickly go back to the threshing floor. We all know the threshing floor is a place after you harvest, there's the straw, and on top we have the grain and covered by the husk. So, very quickly, so it's a place where separation takes place, the grain from the useless straw, and then the husk separated from the valuable part of the crop. In essence, it is a place of separation and revelation. Even as the husk is separated, it is revealed to you what is of value, the grain. Those of you who have been to the Indian subcontinent or on our Bangladesh mission trips will fully understand what this threshing floor is all about as you move into rural Bangladesh. And technically, there's threshing, there's winnowing, and other things, but in essence, it is removing, separating the husk, the useless husk, and revealing what is of value inside. I trust you're getting what we... But we cannot remain at the threshing floor. That threshing floor became an altar. And the altar, Solomon built a temple for it. So here it is. Remember, the threshing floor was important in that sense. It was not cost-free. You remember King David paid. But it is a place initially for separation and revelation. Then the altar can come. And of course, verse 24 says, I will not sacrifice to the Lord my God burnt offerings. That cost me nothing. So, today, we are not asking you for your 50 shekels when you build the altar, but rather to recognize that your sacrifices, driven out of love for God, has to cost you something. What are the things it might cost you? This part is a bit hard-hitting, but it might cost you position, prestige, power, pride. What else? It might be inconvenient. It might take you out of your comfort zone or that complacent atmosphere you are so used to. It might even cost you respectability, wealth, acceptance, and of course, security. No matter how confident many of us appear to be on the outside, deep down, we want that security. And as we said earlier, there is security in the love of God. But for others, when they are called to serve, this could be one of the things it's going to cost them. Health even, and wealth. And in addition to the three T's, your time, your talent, your treasures, and sacrifice at the altar comes with a price. It could be one, it could be a few of those. We have heard so many times. Yes, I will serve, Pastor, don't worry. But wait, I got 2 more years, then I will retire. Sure, I will come. Or, I'm helping my grandchildren to grow up, doing babysitting activities. Or, cash flow is a bit tight. And these are things that are very relevant, and I say to myself, I have at some point said those very words. But friends, be prepared. It will cost you something. And all these are actually what word covers it all. These are our idols. Pastor alluded to the issue of idolatry. And that is going to stand in the place, blocking you as you assess the altar of your life. And very simply, John Piper says idolatry. Listen to this. It is the thing loved or the person loved more than God. Wanted more than God. Desired more than God. Treasured more than God. Enjoyed more than God. So friends, a time to reflect. What are the idols in my life? Have I fully surrendered them to the Lord so that I can enjoy His love, His security, His presence at the altar of my life? So what happens at the altar very quickly? It's a place of encounter. For example, the Lord met Jacob in a crisis. It's a place of forgiveness. Remember the brazen altar outside the tabernacle sacrifice? It's a place, of course, of worship. Man meeting with God and God deserving wholehearted worship. It's a place of covenant, a making of agreement between God and man. Remember the first Mount Moriah encounter that Abraham had. It's a place of intercession. Not just at the altar, you present your Christmas list to the Lord, but to intercede for people, for nations, for communities. And a place, of course, of sacrifice, meaning the idols have to be left behind. And a little play of words, a place of altering for us, we need to be altered. In short, altering means transformation. Again, we go on to our head, heart, and heads. During these weeks ahead, the past weeks too, a lot of information has been given to you. And as you download it, you process it, it has to move to your hearts to transform you. You have to be convicted of what you have heard and read and understood. The altering must take place. And finally, incarnational. You have to add action, put feet and hands to what we are being convicted. And here, during the pandemic, plenty of opportunities for us to put feet and hands to what we believe, serving the community. So where are the altars today? The Mount Moriahs have gone, but the altars remain. My altar is in my heart. Your altar is in your heart. And that's where the fire of the Lord burns. I remember in Leviticus, God commanded the priests. What? His commission to them. The fire shall ever be burning at the altar. It shall never go out. And this same principle in New Testament tabernacle, the church, we, the community of believers, the fire must be burning. Burning 24/7, in the morning, in the noon, evening, night. That's our mission. And that's how we shine forth as light in the darkness. So just now we sang about fanning the flame. All of us are members of this fan club to fan the flame. Remember that. But at the end of the day, we need to ask, is our altar there? Does it need to be established? If it has established what is years ago, does it need to be repaired? Is it broken? Do you have heart equals altar, A broken heart, a hardened heart, and a forgiving heart, a critical heart, an unbelieving heart. These things will hold us back from building and maintaining our altar. So God requires an altar that is burning, not broken down, not non-existent. It's not too late, my friends. Build it, repair it, maintain it, enlarge it. And the prophet Samuel, in 1 Samuel 15, tells us, we now go on a notch further beyond the sacrifice at the altar. Does the Lord delight in burnt offerings and sacrifices as much as obeying the Lord? And the famous words I want to leave with you is, to obey is better than sacrifice. To obey is better than sacrifice. Something else must be present at this altar, your altar. Faith and obedience, to trust and to obey. Even as I invite the worship team to come up, I want to share with you our response song, the third or fourth verse, the John Sammy's famous hymn which we also love. But we never can prove the delights of His love until all on the altar we lay. That's what we want, the full delights of His love. And what does it involve? The favor, the joy that He gives us. And it is all ours if we trust and obey. Even as they get ready, I would like to recap, as you will probably have realized, this is not the usual three-point Methodist sermon. As I try to recap very quickly, I found out we have actually 10 points. So stay with us. First point, we love God, we love people, we make disciples. And it is repetitive, cyclical, overlapping. And it is all centered, the focal, the center of gravity is the Jesus template, walking the way of Jesus, the perfect model, can never go wrong. And one way to love God is to serve Him wholeheartedly, sacrificially, not costly. And altars involve faith and sacrifice, among other things. The threshing floor, before it became an altar, is a place of separation and revelation. Remember, we are called to be set apart, to be separated. And of course, watch out for the idols, because your sacrifices are not cost-free. It will cost you. And be prepared to be altered at the altar. The Mount Moriah altars have long gone. But friends, how is the altar of your heart? Sacrifice is good, nothing wrong with that. But at the end of the day, obedience is better. And ending on a high note, the joy of being in God's love, the favor, the security of being in God's love awaits us if we trust and obey. We can never appreciate the full delights until we surrender all at the altar. And the secret to spiritual success is really, it sounds so simple, but it is to trust and to obey Him. And you need to sacrifice your most beloved things, your very idols, for Him. And the reward awaits you if you trust and obey. Amen. Over to you, Siew Cheng.
We all rise and sing this hymn, Trust and Obey.
When we walk with the Lord in the light of His Word, what a glory He sheds on our way. While we do His good will, He abides with us still, and with all who will trust and obey. Sorrow we share, but our toil.
Please be seated. I think before I give the announcements, let's just quieten ourselves down. And just allow your thoughts to just reflect on what has been shared. And I want to challenge you this morning that even as you leave the service, don't just leave in the same way that you came in. I believe that God has spoken. And therefore, let's just maybe take about 30 seconds in quietness before Him and engage Him. Thank you. Can I also just encourage you to remind each one of us? Henry spoke about Jesus' template, and I think when you look at Jesus, He is not demanding perfection from us. He is not demanding something that we don't have. But I think the encouragement as we read the gospel, Jesus is saying, fine, start from where you are. Even this morning's message may be difficult, but can you just come to Jesus and say, Jesus, let me start from where I am. It is perfectly fine for Him. And therefore, even as we continue to journey with Him, I think let's hear afresh His call, come and see. Come and follow me. Come and be with me. And finally, come and remain in me. Even as this morning's intercession. All right? So, once again, thank you for being part of our worship this morning. And very quickly, I just want to just run through some announcements. Even for this coming week, I just want to highlight on Tuesday night, we will be having our corporate prayer meeting, 8:30 to 10. Now, if you are able to, come and join us, all right? Hear stories, and even as we take some time to just continue to pray for not just our own needs, but the needs of the church, the nation, the nations, and other people as well. And also, Thursday as well as Sunday night, if you are able to, there's the CPA, Children Prayers Altar, 8:15 to 8:45. Thursday is Bahasa, Sunday it is in English. Now, I just want to very quickly also highlight one of the developments is that the seniors, all right, are saying, wow, besai, you know, the children have started. The seniors are also saying, wow, we must also come together to pray, all right? And we want to just encourage and give thanks to God for just stirring the hearts of the seniors. So every first and third Thursday of the month, 1 hour, 9 a.m. to 9 to 10 a.m., the seniors will be coming to pray together. All right, so for the seniors or even for the younger people, if you are free, no harm joining in with our senior congregation and just pray and spend time and pray and learning to pray. All right, so for all the prayers, the QR code is there, tinyurl.com, SSMC prayer. You can just scan that and download the link. Also, the discipleship groups are meeting. We are still meeting online. So please connect with one. And you can also similarly download the QR code. Scan the QR code, sorry. Lunchtime devotion continues every Wednesday and Saturday, 12 to 1 p.m. I think we do have quite a consistent group coming together, and it's also a place where different ones get the opportunity, even as they read the Word of God. It's also a platform for them to share and also to develop, as it were, the skill of not just only sharing what they know, but to develop the kind of skill set that will also help them, even in leading groups, or even in ministering to other people. All right, so if you are able to, join the lunchtime devotion. Children's Church, we are still meeting online every Saturday and Sunday. So similarly, the details are in the QR code. SSMC Youth, they are meeting every Saturday at 4 p.m. I think I shared last week that there is actually a need, and I just want to extend on behalf of the youth ministry team the call for adults counselors to just come in and to help and to journey with our young people. Yeah. Another announcement is basically on the worship ministry. So I asked me to emphasize, although we need different people, that you actually can see to come in to serve, there is an urgent need for more people to come in to help as sound crew. Am I right? Sound crew. Okay. We need people who are willing to be trained, who have an interest in, devices and so on, to just come in and to help and to serve in this important area within the worship ministry. And also not forgetting for musicians as well, and I also will believe singers as well. All right, so if you are able, please talk to Su Ai, and she will see how to connect and move things forward. As you come in through the foyer on the table, we have this Lent meditation. There are two versions prepared by the track Board of Worship and Music. This is free. All right, and you can just take a copy for the adults, and we also have the junior version. All right, it's colorful. And for the more traditional churches, usually Lent is a period of 40 days to the Resurrection Sunday that the church will bring the congregation through a series of reading as well as reflection of a time of thanksgiving, a time of reflection, even as we prepare our hearts to commemorate and to remember not just the death but the resurrection of Christ. So please grab a copy even as you leave the sanctuary this morning. For our gifts and offering, the details are listed here. OCBC Bank, you can just bank in. And for those that are tithing, you can also bank in. But please send a note to Jennifer to say that if you are tithing, this is tithing, so that when the finance or Jennifer does the posting, we will know where to allocate. Okay, so let's rise for the doxology.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise God.
Cheng will lead us in the closing song.
Okay, shall we all sing again? Jesus is over everything. Let's put our hands together even as we sing, okay? Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah.
From glory to
took on flesh to save the lost, grace and mercy displayed upon the cross, our redemption is the hope of all mankind. One name over everything, one name.
Rain.
Let's lift our hands, even as we receive the closing prayer this morning. Jesus Christ is Lord. We acknowledge that you are Lord over our lives. And we want to just pray that even in this coming week, teach us to live in a way to love you, to love people, and also to make disciples. Lord, even as we come to worship you, dismiss us, Lord, that we may be that instrument of blessing to those that are around in this coming week. We want to just give thanks to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Together we say, Amen. Amen. God bless you, and we see you again.